members of the Shepherdstown Library Garden Stewards. Tonight's speaker is the award-winning author and entomologist, Douglas Tallamy, who will outline his vision for a grassroots approach to conservation. Doug's first book, Bringing Nature Home, awakened thousands of readers to an urgent situation. Wildlife populations were dwindling and in decline because the native plants they depended on were rapidly disappearing. Doug's approach to conservation is a guiding principle in the design and plant selections for the library habitat garden. The garden will showcase both the ease and beauty of gardening with native plants while providing for our native pollinators, birds, and other wildlife. It is my pleasure to present Doug Tallamy.
Well, thanks very much. Do you have to stretch? I mean, I kind of have to wake up a little bit. Stand up, stretch. I'm going to look for some water here. All right, that's enough. You know what? I'm going to hold this. Okay. All right, well, thanks for not leaving. Let's talk about nature's best hope. This is my idea of what nature's best hope is. But before we talk about my idea of what nature's best hope is, let's go to Ed Wilson, Dr. E.O. Wilson, Harvard Emeritus. I don't really have to introduce him. Of course, he died the day after Christmas this year, and it was a terrible loss to the world of conservation, the world of sociobiology, the world of myrmecology. Lots of worlds that he literally created himself. Extremely long career, one of the most or the most productive scientific career that we know of. But one of the things that was consistent throughout his career was his love of biodiversity, his love of life, and the fact that he knew it was not optional, that we needed it. So he tried to save it in many of his writings, and this was a culmination of it, his book that came out in 2016 called Half Earth, Our Planet's Fight for Life. And he had one simple message in that book, and that was, if we don't save life, if we don't save functional ecosystems, if we don't save nature on half of planet Earth, we're going to lose it on all of planet Earth. And of course, that means we'll lose ourselves. So that was his message, and he spent most of the book talking about the science that supports that message. Then he ended the book. He didn't spend a whole lot of time talking about how we were actually going to save nature on half of planet Earth. Of course, it's a wonderful idea, and to conservation biologists, we're all very excited. That's great. We'll just put half of the planet aside, and everything will be wonderful. Problem is, half of terrestrial Earth is already in some form of agriculture. We've got 8 billion people in all of our houses and our airports and our detritus in the other half. And only 13% of that other half is formally saved, and that's pretty much on paper in a lot of places. And we don't have a third half to set aside for nature. So how are we actually going to do what EO suggested? That's what I want to talk about tonight. I think we can do it. But in order to realize EO's dream, we're going to need a new approach to conservation. But before we talk about that, let's talk about what happened on the East Coast in 2019. We have what we call an oak mast. Members of the Red Oak group got together and decided to make their acorns at the same time. And that's what it looked like in a lot of places. Well, I'm easily entertained. So I took one of those acorns and I just stared at it. But I was rewarded because an insect started to chew its way out of the acorn, chewed a little hole for its head, then it forced its head capsule through there. Then it proceeded to force its entire body through that little hole. It was a tight squeeze, kind of looked like the Pillsbury Doughboy. Then it plopped down, and that is a very dangerous time for that insect larva because it's good to eat. A lot of things are after it. So it gets to safety by wiggling and squirming beneath the soil surface. It takes about 30 seconds, and once it's underground, stretches in all directions and forms a chamber. And within that chamber, converts itself to a pupa, and then surprisingly stays as a pupa in that chamber underground for 2 years. After 2 years comes out as an acorn weevil. That's what an acorn weevil looks like. A lot of people think weevils have big noses because it looks like they do, but that's actually an extension of the head capsule, and their mouth parts are way down at the end of that extension. They take those mouth parts, chew a hole into the center of the acorn, turn around, lay an egg in that hole, and that is how the larva gets into the acorn. Well, why do they spend 2 years underground? It takes red oak acorns 18 months to complete their development. So if they came out the very next year, there wouldn't be enough acorns for them. Of course, after they leave the acorn, there's a hole in the acorn. It's a kind of a true vacuum, and you know that nature abhors a vacuum. And in this case, she has filled it with three species of Timnothorax ants, tiny little ants where the entire colony lives in the holes made by acorn weevils after the acorn has left the acorn. And if scouts find a new hole in a new acorn, they get all excited because their old acorn's falling apart. So they tell everybody it's time to move the colony. They grab the larvae, they grab the eggs, they move the entire colony into the new hole. It takes about 30 minutes. Then they post a guard, make sure nobody else comes in. And that is where they'll live for the next 2 years until that acorn falls apart. What's my point with this little story? Well, that is just one of literally millions of very specialized interactions, largely between animals and plants, that comprise the bulk of nature. This is another one, the relationship between jays and acorns. Jays are the primary disperser of oak acorns. They'll take an acorn, they'll fly up to a mile from the parent tree. Then they'll tap it below a surface of the soil, and the object is they're going to go back in the wintertime and have something to eat. But for every four acorns they bury, they only remember where one is. So for every four acorns they bury, they've actually planted three oak trees. Specialized interaction between carpenter ants and pileated woodpeckers. That's what pileated woodpeckers rear their young on, carpenter ants. So you won't have pileated woodpeckers unless you have a lot of carpenter ants, and you won't have a lot of carpenter ants unless you have the big trees that make those carpenter ants. You won't have that bee, Andrena facilii, unless you have that plant, Facilia. That is the only pollen that that bee can rear its young on. It turns out pollen specialization, at least in this country, is very common. We have about 4,000 species of native bees, and over a third of them can only reproduce in the pollen of particular plants. You won't have Baltimore checker spots unless you have white turtlehead. I could talk all night, all week, all year about nature's specialized interactions. Point I want to make tonight, though, is that these interactions, nature itself, is on the ropes today. And it's on the ropes because we didn't take Teddy Roosevelt's advice. Way back in 1908, Teddy heard that the state of Arizona was going to mine the Grand Canyon. So he went to the canyon, looked out over the edge, and he said, "Leave it as it is." Those five words, he started the process of creating the Grand Canyon National Park. Well, we didn't leave most of the country as it was. There's only about 5% of the lower 48 states anything close to its original pristine ecological condition, and those are typically mountaintops. And that's because we have logged the country repeatedly. We have tilled it. We have drained it. We have grazed it. We've got 770 million acres of rangeland in this country. That's 4.5 times the size of Texas dedicated to cattle. And of course, we've paved it or otherwise developed it. I think development is the most oxymoronic word in all of ecology. We have straightened our rivers and dammed them, and you can spell that any way you want. We have polluted our skies, changed our climate for centuries to come. We have drained our aquifers. We've introduced more than 3,300 species of plants from other continents, many of which are running amok in our natural areas. In short, we have carved up those natural areas into tiny remnants of their former selves. And each one of those remnants is too small and too isolated to sustain the amount of nature that we need to sustain ourselves. Why have we done this? I don't know. But I suspect we thought that our nest, planet Earth, was so large, we could foul it forever and there wouldn't be any consequences. But of course, we were wrong about that, and that's why we're seeing some pretty scary headlines these days, like the insect apocalypse is here. What does it mean for the rest of life on Earth? Talking about global insect decline, followed by this one, North America's lost 3 billion breeding birds in the last 50 years. That's a third of our North American bird population already gone. And now the UN says we're going to lose a million species to extinction, probably in the next 20 years. And they said that 2 years ago, so now that's the next 18 years. It makes a great headline, but it is not an option, folks. These are the species that keep us alive on planet Earth. We've got to make sure this doesn't happen. So So I could go on talking about the pox that we humans have delivered upon the environment, thus upon all of our houses. But that's not what this talk is about. This talk's about a cure for that pox. It's a cure that'll take small efforts from lots of people, people like you and me, but those efforts to deliver enormous physical, psychological, and environmental benefits to everybody. Let's return briefly to this headline. The insect apocalypse is here. What does it mean for the rest of life on Earth? Well, back to E.O. Wilson. He told us what it would mean, and Dennis gave this away. What it would mean if planet Earth lost its insects, and he did it way back in 1987 with this paper, The Little Things that Run the World. And again, his message was very clear. Life as we know it depends on insects. And if they were to disappear, so would most of our flowering plants. And if most of our flowering plants disappeared, that would so drastically change energy flow through our terrestrial ecosystems that the food webs that support our animals, our amphibians, our reptiles, our birds, our mammals, those food webs would collapse and all those animals would disappear. The biosphere, the living portion of the earth, would rot because we would have lost insect decomposers that rapidly turn over nutrients, and all we would have is bacteria and fungi. And of course, humans wouldn't survive any of those drastic changes. There is some good news here, and that is that none of that has to happen. We can save our insects, we can save our birds, we can save nature itself. But we're going to have to change the way we landscape in order to do it. Why is that? Well, remember, humans are products of nature. We are totally dependent on the life support that healthy ecosystems provide. We call them ecosystem services. Here are just a few things that plants do that we benefit from every single day, like they produce oxygen, pretty important. They clean water, flow its journey to the sea where it becomes too salty to use. They capture carbon, enormously important in today's world. They're pulling carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere, out of harm's way, building their tissues out of that carbon. And then what a lot of people don't realize is that they're pumping the extra carbon through their roots into the soil. Our soils are brown or black because of carbon that plant roots have deposited there over the eons. And once it's in the soil, it's stable. It'll stay there thousands of years. Plants are building topsoil, holding it in place, very important, preventing floods, dampening severe weather, converting sunlight into food. If we lose our plants, we're going to have to eat sunlight. That'll be hard. What do animals do for plants? Lots of things, but very importantly, they provide pest control services. As we said, they pollinate nearly 90% of those flowering plants. They disperse plant seeds. So designing landscapes like this, just not a good idea. Landscapes that destroy the production of ecosystem services. It's not a good idea, never was a good idea, but today it's actually a terrible idea because we've got so many people demanding more and more ecosystem services every day, and we're taking them, but we're taking them from other life forms, and that's why we're in the sixth great extinction. Now we do have parks, we have preserves, they're doing the best they can, but it's obviously not good enough or we wouldn't be in the sixth great extinction event. So now we're going to have to start practicing conservation outside of parks and preserves, on landscapes just like this. There have been visionaries through the ages who have recognized that we humans needed to work on our relationship with planet Earth, and Aldo Leopold was one of the most eloquent. He wrote extensively in the first half of the 1900s, and one of the things he said is the oldest task in human history is to live in a piece of land without spoiling it. Now, there have been indigenous groups that have been able to do that for long periods, but our huge Western societies, our huge Asian societies, are terrible at doing that. We habitually take more from the planet, more from the Earth than it has to offer, completely wrecking an area, going to another area, doing the same thing, not sustainable behavior. But Aldo Leopold had a lot of faith in humans. He believed that we were capable of developing what he called a land ethic. He knew we had to use the land, we had to farm and lumber and graze and mine and do all of those things. But he believed we were smart enough to learn how to do those things gently enough that we did not destroy local ecosystems. That's what he called a land ethic, and he wrote about it in the Sand County Almanac, his most famous book. What he did not write about, though, was creating a land ethic where we actually lived. And I don't know why he didn't do that, but I suspect the notion that humans and nature cannot live together, cannot coexist in the same place at the same time, that notion was so deeply embedded in the culture of Aldo Leopold's day still embedded in our own culture, that he may not have recognized it as an option. Well, what I want to talk about tonight is that not only is living with nature an option, it is now the only option that's left to us. In the past, of course, conservationists worked pretty much exclusively where there weren't a lot of people. We now need to turn that on its head. We need to practice conservation where there are a lot of people, because that's pretty much everywhere. In other words, we've got to find ways for nature to thrive in human-dominated landscapes. Not hang on by a thread, not get diminished every single year, but thrive. Where should we start? Let's go back to private property. Most of the country is privately owned. 78% of the country is privately owned. 85.6% of the U.S. east of the Mississippi is privately owned. If we don't practice conservation on private property, we're going to fail. Now, when I use the word conservation, I'm not using it correctly. We certainly want to conserve any bits of nature that are left out there, and that has been our conservation model for the last 100 years. But we now need to go beyond that. We need to restore. We need to put the nature that we've dismantled back together again in all those places that we have dismantled it. In other words, we have to, it's called restoration biology, restoration ecology. And before you tell me that you'll never put it back exactly the way it was, I know that. But we can reunite enough of those specialized interactions so that you have a functioning ecosystem once again, delivering ecosystem services. It may not be exactly what was on that piece of land at some point in the past, but it still can be a functional ecosystem. In order to do this, though, we have to start with the building blocks of ecosystems. Not all species contribute to ecosystem function equally. So we have to start with the most important species. And there's two groups that we can't do without. One is the flowering plants, and of course, the pollinators that allow those plants to reproduce. They are capturing energy from the sun, using it for their own growth and reproduction. And storing that energy, turning it into food, and that is the food that supports all the animals on at least terrestrial Earth. Well, all the animals, just about. Very few exceptions. So we get the food that supports animals stored in plant parts, primarily leaves. We have to get that energy, that food, to animals, or you don't have any animals. Most vertebrates, it turns out, do not eat plants directly. Most vertebrates eat invertebrates that ate plants. Most of those invertebrates are insects, and it turns out, not just any insects. It is caterpillars that are transferring more energy from plants to other animals than any other type of plant eater. So if we design landscapes that don't have a lot of caterpillars in them, we've got eventually failed food webs and then failed ecosystems. Let's use the Carolina chickadee as an example. That's the chickadee that occurs in southeast Pennsylvania where I live. I think you're probably in a transition zone here. You've got the black-capped chickadee farther north. There's chickadees in the west. They're all practically the same bird doing the same thing. Those are the birds, some of the birds that are at our feeders all winter long, eating seeds. But only 50% of their diet in the winter is seeds. The other 50%, even in the wintertime, is insects and spiders. But when they go to reproduce, their babies can't eat seeds at all. So they have to give up the seeds, and they switch to invertebrates, largely insects. And if they are in a healthy environment, they will rear their young exclusively on caterpillars. And they are not exceptions. 96% of our terrestrial birds rear their young on insects, and most of those insects are caterpillars. How do I know that? There's lots of evidence that suggests that. But this is a citizen science project that one of my grad students did a few years ago, Ashley Kennedy. She put out a call to bird photographers across the country. Some of you might have participated. And she said, please take pictures of birds when they're carrying food to the nest. And send those pictures to me, Ashley. I will identify the prey items that are in the beaks of the birds and reconstruct as many species or as many the nestling diet for as many species of birds in North America as I can. It was very successful. She got thousands of pictures. She did a lot of identifying. And you're looking at a summary of her results. The 20 most common bird families in North America. The green bars are the percentage of the nestling diets of those bird families that were caterpillars. And in 16 out of the 20 common bird families, caterpillars dominated the diet. So again, what would happen if we designed landscapes that don't have enough caterpillars in it? Most of our birds wouldn't be able to successfully reproduce. So it seems like there's something special about caterpillars. What is it? There's actually several things special about caterpillars, and one of them is that they are soft. Think of this guy as if he's a little sausage with a very thin wrapper. The thin wrapper is exoskeleton, it's made of chitin, it's undigestible, and the birds don't want a lot of that. And because they're soft, you can stuff it down the throat of your offspring without fear of injuring them. And if you've ever watched a parent bird rear their young, they're pretty rough. The beak is like a plunger, just stuff it down there. Caterpillars are also relatively large prey items. One medium-sized caterpillar is equal to the biomass of 200 aphids. And some of our smaller birds do chase aphids around, but do you want to chase 200 aphids or get one caterpillar? They are nutritious, they're high in fat, high in protein, they have a low percentage of exoskeleton of chitin compared to many other types of insects, particularly beetles. Beetles are not like little sausages, they're like little tanks. And a lot of beetles have very sharp edges too. And then finally, it turns out that caterpillars are the best source of carotenoids for birds during the breeding season. Now, I mention carotenoids not because I love organic chemistry, but because I'm a vertebrate, and you're a vertebrate, and birds are vertebrates. And we vertebrates cannot make our own carotenoids. Only plants make carotenoids, so we have to get our carotenoids from plants. And we have to get them from plants because carotenoids are essential components of vertebrate diets. Where are birds getting their carotenoids from, particularly during the breeding season? Well, the invertebrates that they're eating. Remember, in the spring, there aren't any berries or seeds. The plants haven't made them yet. They're relying on insects. But look, carotenoid content is not equally distributed among bird prey items. The first two bars over here on the left are types of caterpillars, and they have far more carotenoids than other types of bird prey. There are the adult caterpillars there, the moths and butterflies themselves. They have far fewer carotenoids because they're not eating the green leaves. The carotenoids are in the green leaves. And way over here on the right is the earthworm. So the early bird gets the worm, but he doesn't get any carotenoids when he gets the worm. The point is, for most birds, caterpillars are not optional parts of their diet. They're an essential part of their diet. So let's just say most birds need caterpillars. Question is, how many caterpillars do they need? That's a good question. Let's go back to chickadees, because we've got a lot of data on chickadees. Is one or two enough, or one or two a day enough? No. One or two is not enough. One or two a day is not enough. They need thousands of caterpillars to get one clutch of chickadees just to the point where they leave the nest. 6,000 to 9,000 caterpillars to make it to fledging, depending on the number of chicks in the nest. And after they fledge, after they leave the nest, the parents continue to feed them caterpillars another 21 days. But they're flying all around, so nobody's been able to count that. And if you want chickadees to breed in your yard, you've got to have all those caterpillars in your yard because they only forage about 50 meters from the nest. And chickadees aren't exceptions. Most birds forage very close to the nest. They don't want to use more energy than they're getting from the food. They are not flying 5 miles down the road to the nearest woodlot. And if we landscape in a way that does not include all those caterpillars in our yards, that's called insect decline. And it's really looking like there's a direct correlation between insect declines and the bird declines that people are measuring. We went to the original data set of Rosenberg et al. That's the Smithsonian group that said we've lost 3 billion birds, and divided the terrestrial bird species in North America into two groups: the species that require insects, particularly when they're breeding, and the species that don't require insects. So things like finches and doves can actually make a little milk out of seeds, and they can reproduce without seeds. And look, they didn't lose any numbers at all in the last 50 years. But the species that require insects, the true insectivores, lost on average 10 million individuals per species. So it doesn't prove cause and effect, but it certainly does suggest that as you take the bird food away, you lose the birds. So we need a new approach to landscape design. In the past, we've had one goal, and that was to make our landscapes pretty. And that's a good goal. We're not going to give that up. We have to expand it. We want to make pretty landscapes that are also ecologically functional, and you're not going to do that unless you have a lot of caterpillars in those landscapes. So how do we add caterpillars to landscapes? You add caterpillars by adding the plants that support those caterpillars. It seems pretty straightforward, but there is a catch, and that is that most plants do not support a lot of caterpillars. So we have to be fussy about it. We have to choose the plants that do, and we have to be fussy about it because the caterpillars themselves are fussy about it. That's a monarch butterfly larva. And you can have all the crepe myrtle and all the calorie pear and all the burning bush and all the barberry and all the miscanthus and all the things we typically landscape with, and most of them are from Asia, in your yard, and you won't make a single monarch butterfly. Only thing that's going to make a monarch butterfly is one of the milkweed species. That is called host plant specialization, and it turns out that most of the insects that eat plants are host plant specialists. Why? Because plants have made them that way. Plants don't want to be eaten. They want to capture the energy from the sun and through photosynthesis create all that food, which again they want to use for their own growth and reproduction. They don't want to share it with insects, so they protect their tissues with nasty chemicals, secondary metabolic compounds that make those tissues either bitter or downright toxic. And it's a really effective defense that keeps most of the insects of the world from eating most of the plants of the world. And if you don't believe me, as you go to your car tonight, grab a plant and eat it. See if you like it. You're not going to like it. There's a reason we can't get our kids to eat their vegetables. It's because they inherently know they're toxic. No more jokes. I lose my glasses. We do know that insects eat plants. So how do they do that? Well, this is where the specialization comes in. 90% of the insects that eat plants are host plant specialists, just like the monarch. They can only eat particular plant lineages for which they have developed specialized adaptations that allow them to get around those chemical defenses. They develop enzymes that store and excrete and detoxify those compounds, behavioral adaptations and life history adaptations that minimize the insect's exposure to those compounds. It does take a long period of evolutionary history with that particular plant lineage for all those adaptations to fall into place, but once they do, the insect is locked into eating that particular plant. So if you take all the milkweeds out of your yard and replace them with hostas, the monarch's not going to start to develop on hostas. Can't do it. It's locked into milkweeds. So it has two choices. It can fly away and find milkweed someplace else, it hopes, or starve to death. Turns out there's three kinds of plants out there. There are plants that actually contribute food to local food webs. There are plants that do not contribute food to local food webs. And there are plants that actively detract food from local food webs. A great example of a contributor would be one of the oaks. They're contributing more energy than just about any other plant genus in the country. A good example of a non-contributor would be a ginkgo. Ginkgo biloba from Asia. Nothing eats a ginkgo, so it's not adding any energy to the local food web. It's not taking it away. It's not an invasive plant, but it's just kind of sitting there. And a good example of a plant that is taking it away would be calorie pear, Bradford pear. Because when we plant them, their seeds don't stay there. They escape and they become serious invasive species in our natural areas, pushing out the plants that do contribute and replacing them with a plant that doesn't. So all I'm trying to say here is that plant choice matters. If we're trying to rebuild a food web to establish a functional ecosystem, we have to choose the right plants or it's not going to happen. And I'm going to give you three examples of how well it does work when we do choose the right plant. And I'm going to start with my house, our house, right, where my wife Cindy and I moved in Oxford, Pennsylvania, way back in the year 2000. We got a piece of a farm that was broken up into 10-acre lots. It was a very old farm, been farmed almost 300 years, and the last thing they did was mow it for hay. And so, not much there when we moved in. And we really wanted to put that eastern deciduous forest back. I thought I knew how to do that, but back then I really didn't. I did like caterpillars, though, so I decided to try to landscape in a way that would allow caterpillars to start to make a living at our house. And this was one of the early ones I tried to attract, the Canadian owlet. I'd never seen a Canadian owlet before, and I chose a Canadian owlet because I was looking through Dave Wagner's book of Caterpillars of the Eastern North America, and I said, that's a pretty one. Because people thought that there's a lot of thought went into this. That's what the adult looks like. Well, you don't have Canadian owlets unless you have Meadow Rue, their host plant specialist on meadow rue. Just like monarchs are on milkweeds, Canadian owlets are on meadow rue, and we didn't have any meadow rue. No meadow rue anywhere around us. The whole area had been farmed for hundreds of years, so the meadow rue was long gone. I got some meadow rue seeds from someplace, and I planted them, and they grew very nicely. But this was early on. I had a little patch of meadow rue, and I actually had very little faith that Canadian owlets would appear out of nowhere and colonize my meadow rue. So I didn't even go out and check it for about 2 months after I planted it. Then one day I was walking by for some other reason. I looked over, and there were Canadian owlets all over it. I'm still surprised at that. Big success. So now we have a good population of Canadian owlets and meadow rue. We've added two species to this depleted farmland. The restoration has begun. Same story with this beautiful moth, the goldenrod stowaway. It's a misnomer, has nothing to do with goldenrod. It is a specialist on that plant, Biden's aristosa, ditch daisy. I did know where there was some ditch daisy in a power line cut 14 miles away. Got some seeds, planted them at home. They grew very nicely. That is now my front yard. They didn't grow where I wanted them to, but that's okay. But it took a year for the goldenrod stowaway to find my patch of Biden's aristosa, but they did, and now we've got a good population of both of those. Now we've added four species to the property. Same story with the hackberry emperor. I wanted the hackberry emperor not because it's the most beautiful butterfly in the world, but because it belongs there. It's one of the species that should be at our house. But as its name suggests, it's a specialist on hackberry, on celtus. We didn't have any hackberry, so I got four or five hackberry trees. I planted them. It took 4 years for the hackberry emperor to find my hackberry, but they did, and now we've got good populations of them as well. So now we've added six species, and that's how it went. I did not plant goldenrod. Came in on its own, and along with it came many of the things that specialize on goldenrod, like the brown-hooded owlet, the Arcidura flower moth, the goldenrod leaf miner, the distinct Sparagonothus, the goldenrod gall moth. This is one that hasn't come, the goldenrod flower moth. That's what its caterpillars look like. I don't know why it hasn't come. I have some ideas, but I haven't proven them yet. But it's still part of the fun. It's anticipation. It's like waiting for the ketchup to come out of the bottle. Every year I go out and I look for those caterpillars right now, this time of year, on my goldenrod. One of these years I'm going to find it, and that'll be a great year. Planted Virginia creeper. Yes, Virginia creeper. I know a lot of people don't like it, but I don't know why. It's a great native plant. It does everything. It climbs our trees without girdling them, without harming them. It's got good fall color, makes valuable berries for the birds in the fall. They're very high in fat. Birds want high fat berries during migration. That's what fuels that migration. It's a good ground cover. It's a great pollinator plant, believe it or not. The flowers that make those berries are tiny and inconspicuous. You don't even know it's in flower until you see this cloud of native bees around it. I planted it because it's the best source. Oh, by the way, when you're making a pollinator garden, you're making it for the pollinators. If it's not big and showy for you, that's okay. I planted Virginia creeper because it's the best host plant for the large sphinx moths that are a primary component of cardinal diets. Things like the Pandora sphinx and its beautiful adult, the leopard sphinx, the hog sphinx, the abbot sphinx, all on Virginia creeper. I want to see if I could get the double tooth prominent at our house because it's such a cool looking caterpillar. Even if you don't like caterpillars, you've got to like that guy. Well, it's a specialist on elm, particularly American elm. And of course, we didn't have any American elm. We lost it to the Dutch elm disease decades ago. But there are two big American elms at the University of Delaware that did not die. And every year they make a lot of seed. So shortly after we moved in, they gathered up some seed from the curb, the gutter, planted them at home. They germinate in 6 days and they start growing rapidly. Today, those trees are 80 feet tall. None of them have gotten sick, by the way. And they brought in the double tooth prominent, no problem. American elm. Want to see if I get the evening primrose moth at our house because it's beautiful. I like beauty like anybody else. Well, believe it or not, we didn't have any evening primrose, any Oenothera, so I planted that. The moth did come, spends the day with its head stuffed in the flowers. Sometimes it's crowded in there, but it's very cute. And I planted lots of oaks. Now, those are just examples of the plant lineages we put back on our property, but I want to focus on oaks for a while because they are such important plants. That is the Bedford oak in Bedford, New York, Martha Stewart land. People argue about whether it's 400 years old or 500 years old. It's enormous. And I hear, quite often, I hear people say, I'm not going to plant an oak because I won't live long enough to enjoy it. And if you can only enjoy your oak when it's 400 years old, you're right. You won't. But if you can enjoy what your oak contributes to your local food web, you can enjoy it right away. And I can say that with confidence because I planted most of my oaks as acorns, which means they were free, or as two-foot bare root whips, which means they cost $1.50 each. And immediately they started to bring in the moths that eat oaks, that create the caterpillars that drive the food web in my yard. Things like the solitary oak leaf miner, juvenile's dusky wing, the yellow-shouldered moth, the orange, or this is Suzuki's promelactis, the red-washed caterpillar, the yellow-vested moth, the orange-tufted oneida, the spiny oak caterpillar, the two-spotted oak punky, the variable oak leaf caterpillar, the red-humped oak worm, the pink-striped oak worm, the hesitant dagger moth, the lesser oak dagger moth, the greater oak dagger moth, the streaked dagger moth, the afflicted dagger moth, the crown bugulatrix, the orange pet smoky wing, the white blotched heterocampa, the oblique heterocampa, the red lined panapota, the laffer, and literally hundreds more species of moths have come to the oaks on my property, and they come right away. That's a pin oak that has just popped its head above the leaves, and there's a caterpillar standing on the ground eating the leaves of that tree. You don't have to wait decades or hundreds of years for your oaks to start to rebuild that food web at your house. They will do it right away. By the way, that's what our house looks like today. Actually, today there's the Biden's patch right there. It moved. But we put a lot of plants back. Not all the plants. I'm still doing it when I get a chance. But as our research proceeded through the years, we learned just how important caterpillars really were. I'm glad I liked them to begin with, because that is exactly what I should have done to rebuild the food web, was put those caterpillars back. And if you count the number of particularly moth species, for every species of butterfly, there are 19 species of moths. So it's moths that are driving the food web. And if you know the number of species of moths that are making a living at your house, you have a very good index of the quality, the stability, the diversity of the food web and the life around you. So 5 years ago, I decided to try to count all the species of moths that are making a living at my house. It's a big job, and I am still at it. But so far, I've counted 1,190 species of moths. I added another one last night. So I'm still at it. I don't know how high it will go. It has slowed down, but it's a lot of species. Now, we have 10 acres. Pennsylvania is 2.4 million acres. So on 1/240,000th of the land mass, we have 44% of all the moths that occur in the entire state. And because so many of those moth species are types of bird food, we have recorded 60 species of birds that have bred on our 10 acres. Not flew by, but bred. Why am I telling you this? Well, this is the other really scary headline that we see repeatedly. The World Wildlife Fund says that Earth has lost, what, two-thirds of its wildlife since 1970. But I'm thinking, not at our house. I am sure we have increased biodiversity by more than two-thirds, and it didn't take that long, and it wasn't that hard. We just put the plants back. What would happen if everybody put the plants back? Sure, we're going to lose some species, but we could turn this around. This would not be so scary if we all put the plants back. So don't give up. But I know what you're thinking. We've got 10 acres. A lot of people don't have that much land. Will it work on smaller properties in, say, suburbia? That is a good question. So let's go to Margie and Dan Terpstra's house in Kirkwood, Missouri. They have 0.6 acres, 18 times less land than Cindy and I have. And they live in the middle of a development. Everybody's got the big lawns around them. When they moved into their property, it was choked with bush honeysuckle, armor honeysuckle, another invasive from Asia. So the first thing they did was get rid of that. They planted 70 species of native plants, put in a water feature, and then they sat back and started to record the number of birds that are using their property. And they are up to 149 bird species, including 35 warbler species. Now, if you know anything about birds, you'll know that 35 warbler species, that's a very good number. Just to put it in comparison to our house, we've only recorded 8 warbler species at our house. So does it work on smaller properties? Absolutely. What about urban yards, though? Let's go to Pam Carlson's house in Chicago. And I mean in Chicago. She is right next to O'Hare Airport. That's one of the O'Hare towers over there. She has 1/10 of an acre. That's 3 times smaller than the average lot size in North America. She's not connected to any natural area at all. So she's a little island in the middle of Chicago. It's a pretty island, because Pam is a native plant designer, but she did the same thing. She got rid of her non-native plants, planted 60 species of native plants, put in a water feature, and then she sat back, she says, with a glass of wine, and counted the birds that use her yard, and she's up to 124 bird species that have used her yard, including a woodcock. There's Pam's woodcock. She sent me that picture. So if you haven't seen a woodcock lately, go to Pam's house. It's sitting right there. All right, there's four things we need to think about if we're going to succeed in a big way. And we need to succeed in a big way. And the first is we've got to shrink those big lawns. We've got 44 million acres of lawn in this country. That's an area bigger than New England, which is dedicated to an ecological deadscape. Why do we do that? We do it because it's a status symbol and because we have to display our Halloween decorations. But what if we cut the area of lawn in half? Not get rid of it, let's just cut it in half. What if we took areas like this and started to replant them? A guy by the name of Dan Getman. I've never met Dan, but he sent me this picture. He said, look, I'm doing it. I had this big lawn and I'm putting in these native plants. This is the second year of the planting. Well, that would give us 20 million acres that we could put towards conservation, and if we did it at home, we could create what I'm calling Homegrown National Park. And it will be bigger than the Adirondacks, plus Yellowstone, plus Yosemite, Grand Tetons, Canyonlands, Mount Rainier, North Cascades, Badland National Park, Olympic National Park, Sequoia National Park, plus the Grand Canyon, plus Denali, which is huge, plus the Great Smoky Mountains. Add up all those parks, still less than 20 million acres. So Homegrown National Park would be the biggest park in the country. What do you get when you put a park at home? What do you get when you put some part of nature right where you live? You get the opportunity to interact with it. You get the opportunity to fall in love with Mother Nature. Have a personal relationship with it, and you can do it at your own pace, your own timing. All you have to do is go outside. Or maybe even all you have to do is look out your window. You can avoid crowds. Last year, 375 million people went to our real national parks. So that's what you get to interact with if you go there. It's free. There's no admission fee. It's never closed, no matter what pandemic comes down the pike. No travel hassles. You get to experience the natural world alone, which, you know, for a lot of people, that's why you go to a national park. And I think that alone stuff is important. That not mediated by somebody else. You're going to develop a personal relationship with some part of the natural world. And this is particularly important for our poor kids who are suffering from nature deficit disorder, according to Richard Louvre. So we're trying. We get 30 kids. We put them on a bus with a teacher, and they drive for an hour, and they walk around a natural area. And the teacher tells them not to touch anything. Then they get back in the bus and they go home, and that's their experience with the natural world, which I'm sure is better than nothing. But it's really been an experience with 30 other kids and a teacher telling them not to touch anything. If they have some part of the natural world right where they live, all they have to do is go outside and become friends with it, get to know it, understand it, work out a relationship on their own. No parental supervision. They will come home again. You know, when we hover over our kids, we're sending the message that this is dangerous. This might even be evil. That's not the message we want to send about Mother Nature, because our kids are the future stewards of the planet. If they don't know that, if they don't know how to steward it, if they're afraid of nature, they're going to be lousy stewards. And we can't afford any more lousy stewardship. And maybe they will learn how to hunt lizards. I'm learning this from my own granddaughter, Zoe, who lives in Hawaii on a very modest patch of nature. It's a little piece of lawn with a hedge. But there are Noel lizards there. And when she discovered that, she sent me this slide to explain how you hunt lizards. You get on the ground and you cover yourself with leaves and sticks so the lizards can't see them coming. Then you crawl very slowly toward the lizard. No smiling. This is serious business here. You can wear your best dress. That's okay. But you sneak up on the lizard. You catch the lizard. You put it in an aquarium. You learn how to take care of a lizard, hopefully before it dies. But you learn how to be a good steward of that part of nature. You fall in love with that part of nature. Now, I don't think Zoe's going to be crawling on the ground in her best dress catching lizards the rest of her life. I don't think. She sent me this picture, so who knows. But I guarantee she's going to remember catching lizards in Hawaii the rest of her life, and I guarantee she's going to be a good steward of the planet. If you want your kids to do more than catch lizards, get Nancy Strinisty's Nature Play at Home. Dozens of examples of how to expose kids to nature right where they live. And if you want to join Homegrown National Park, you can do it now. Go to homegrownnationalpark.org, that's our website, and register your property on the map. It's free. That just means you're going to put down your location in your county and the amount of area you're being a good steward of. Or you plan to be a good steward. It's like a pledge. If you're really going to cut your lawn in half, that's great. If you have a woodlot and you're on your property and you're protecting that, that goes on the map. Maybe you're putting an aster in a flower pot on your balcony. Good enough. You get to record that area on the map, and then your little piece of your county is going to light up. And the object is to get the whole country to light up. The real object here is to change the culture, to reach beyond the choir. People always tell me, you just talk to the choir. I say, well, it's just the choir that invites me. We've got to, and they're right, we've got to reach the millions of people who don't know that they are an essential part of the future of conservation. We're hoping that this message will go viral and people will join it just because of the social, whatever social media does to your brain. So, and tell your neighbor, get your neighbor to join Homegrown Net, because they're not here tonight. All right, we're gonna shrink the lawn. What plants should we put in the area where it was once grass? I'm going to argue that some of them have to be keystone plants. Remember what a keystone is? It's the stone in the middle of the Roman arch. And if you take that stone out of the arch collapses. Well, if you take keystone plants out of the local food web collapses because they are making most of that caterpillar food that runs that food web. Just 14% of our native plants are supporting 90% of the caterpillars that are out there. So think of the keystone plants as the 2x4s that are holding up the ecological house that you're building. They're essential. They are the support. You cannot build an ecological house out of wallpaper, and that's what we've been trying to do for the last 100 years. You are not through building your house when you have your keystone plants, but they're an essential start. So the question is no longer simply, are natives better than non-natives ecologically? On average, they certainly are. But there are a lot of species of natives that don't contribute all that much. So the question really is, do we want to focus on those contributors, the ones that are contributing the most to support the bees and the caterpillars, or not? What is supporting more caterpillars than anything else? It's one of our oaks, genus Quercus, 557 species in the mid-Atlantic states. And I think in our study that included West Virginia. Over 950 species of caterpillars supported nationwide. There's no other plant genus that comes close to that. So if you want to know what the best plants are in your county, go to Native Plant Finder on the National Wildlife Federation website and put in your zip code and the ranked list of both the woody and herbaceous plant genera that are best in your county will pop up. So this way you can do this all over the country, doesn't matter where you live. I want to focus on the right here. I don't think you can see my little pointer, but the three in most areas of the country, the three most important herbaceous plants in terms of supporting both caterpillars and specialist bees are goldenrod, solidagos, the native asters, and perennial sunflowers. If you have those three genera, not only are you going to make, you're going to support lots and lots of caterpillars, but you're going to support more species of specialist bees than other plants. If we plant a pollinator garden, we want to focus on those specialist bees because the generalist bees will use those plants as well. If you have goldenrods, asters, and sunflowers in your yard, you can support up to 44 species of bees that will not be there if you don't have those particular genera. Again, the generalist bees there will be there no matter what you put in. So we're going to shrink the lawn, we're going to put in keystone plants, we're going to invite a lot of insects to our yard, and then we're going to kill them with our security light, which is not the goal. There is a lot of evidence coming out now that is really tying light pollution at night to insect declines. These are all the ways that our lights are killing insects every single night. Primarily those nocturnal moths that make the caterpillars that run our food webs. This is good news to me, folks, because we've got to turn insect declines around. Remember the little things that run the world? Not just in the decline. We've got to turn it around. We've got to increase insects. And if we can do that by flicking a switch, we're getting off easy. There are a lot of switches to flick, but we're good switch flickers. But I know what you're gonna say. I cannot flick the switch on my garage or my barn or my front yard, my front porch, because the bad man will come. All right, put a motion sensor on it. So it only turns on when the bad man does come. And the first thing you'll realize is the bad man doesn't come very often. And if you don't want to do that, take the white bulb out of your security light and put in a yellow bulb. Ace Hardware sells bug lights. You know, I don't like the word bug. A bug is a disease. We're talking about insects. Yellow lights, yellow LED lights are the best because nocturnal insects are far less attracted to yellow wavelengths. And of course, LEDs support are a lot more energy efficient. If we switched out our white bulbs for yellow bulbs, overnight we'd save millions of insects. And again, if we use LEDs, you'd save millions of dollars. All right, we're going to shrink the lawn. We're going to use keystone plants. We're going to turn out our lights or put motion sensors on them or put in yellow bulbs. And then we're going to invite a mosquito fogger to come and kill all of our insects. Booming business around the country. But they say it's okay. It's a natural product, and that makes it safe. The natural product is pyrethroids. It's industrial strength pyrethroids, but that's the compound that is in chrysanthemums, and that's supposed to make it okay. Remember why that compound is in chrysanthemums? It's because it kills insects that eat chrysanthemums. But cyanide is a natural product too. So I don't think this natural product thing is a good argument. They also say it only kills mosquitoes, and I wish they were right. I really do, but they're not. It kills all the insects it comes in contact with, including those monarchs that we're trying to save that are now listed by the IUCN. Hundreds of dead monarchs on the ground a couple years ago when they flew through Mosquito Joe. The interesting thing is, the ironic thing is, it does not control mosquitoes. You don't try to control mosquitoes in the adult stage. It's too hard. You've got to kill 90% of the adults to control the population. Mosquito Joe kills between 10 and 50%. So it's not even close to being effective, which means it has to keep coming back and back and keep charging you. It's quite expensive. If you really want to control mosquitoes, do it in the larval stage. Get a bucket, fill it full of water. People say, how big a bucket? I don't care. Get a bucket, fill it full of water, put in some organic matter, things like a handful of straw or hay or some dead leaves and maybe some dead grass. Put it out in the sun and let algae and diatom populations build up. That is what mosquito larvae eat, and that becomes an irresistible brew to the female mosquitoes that want to lay their eggs, ovipositing mosquitoes. They will lay their eggs in your bucket. Then you go to the hardware store and you get a sheet of mosquito dunks. Somewhere like $9 a sheet or something. That's Bacillus thuringiensis. This is biological control. That is a natural bacterium that only kills aquatic diptera. And the only aquatic dipteran in your bucket is a mosquito larva. So if a dragonfly gets in your bucket, it's not going to hurt it a bit. If your dog drinks it, it's not going to hurt it. You know, put a coarse screen over your bucket so the chipmunk doesn't jump in and drown. But it's extremely targeted, cheap, and effective, particularly if everybody did it. But you know, if you're gonna have a party in your backyard and you're worried about the mosquitoes getting you, get a fan, turn it on, and put it behind you, and it creates a blow that's strong enough to keep the mosquitoes away that one day. I mean, and most people are not outside that much. You're not fooling me. I know you're not. So this is the cheapest way to do it. All right, the fourth thing we need to do is to landscape in a way that allows those all-important caterpillars to complete their development. What do I mean by that? Well, I live in Chester County, Pennsylvania, where oaks support 511 species of caterpillars. Now, this is just an example. A few of them, like the polyphemus moth, complete their development on the tree. The caterpillar eats the leaves, then it spins a cocoon and hangs from the branches, then it emerges as an adult, and then it does it all over again. Everything happens on the tree, but that's an exception. Most species finish growing as caterpillars on the tree and then they drop from the tree and they wiggle their way underground if the soil's not too compacted and pupate underground, or they spin a cocoon in the leaf litter that's under the tree. And that's the problem. There is no leaf litter under the tree. We don't tolerate it, and we mow and compact our soils so that they're rock hard, particularly in the dry summer, so that our caterpillars cannot get underground. and this becomes an ecological trap. If a moth does find your tree and lay its eggs and the caterpillars grow and they drop down, then they die. And I'm convinced that this is another major cause of insect declines around the country. And of course, the cement landscape is not going to help those caterpillars either. This is what most people do. You've got a tree in a yard. I've got a new grad student this summer who's starting to measure how well caterpillars do in a situation like this. But I guarantee they're going to do better in a situation like this where you have a layered landscape. You've got a tree, and maybe a native dogwood and azalea and ferns and ground cover. This is soft landing. The caterpillars fall down. The ground is not compacted. Nobody's going to mow it. Nobody's going to step on them. Plenty of leaf litter down there. They can easily spin their cocoon. Survivorship will be much higher. This is where you can do your fancy spring ephemeral gardening. This is how you shrink the lawn, folks. Put beds around your trees. First put the tree in, then put a bed around it. And then you're not going to mow it and walk on it, and it becomes a safe site for those caterpillars. And the tree will love it. They don't like grass that goes right up to them. Use native ground covers liberally. This is wild ginger, native pachysandra. There's the Parthenocissus, the Virginia creeper, great ground cover. Golden seal, May apples, foam flower, ferns, lots of examples. This is what you want to see in the ground. You want to see green mulch. If you see bare soil or bark mulch, you need more plants. That all becomes wonderful safe sites for those caterpillars, and the tree will love it. Okay, another former grad student, Desiree Narango, did some wonderful work with chickadees in the suburbs of Washington, D.C., and one of the take-homes from her study is that there's actually room for compromise in our plant choices, and that's good news to me. She had one simple question. And that was, in residential landscapes inside the beltway of Washington, D.C., what happens to chickadee populations over time when they are in landscapes that are dominated by native plants versus landscapes dominated by introduced non-native plants? And when they're dominated by introduced plants, they supported or produced 75% fewer caterpillars than when they had native plants. So right away, you've reduced the amount of bird food by 75%. Those landscapes were 60% less likely to have breeding chickadees at all. Now, every one of these residential landscapes had a nest box up in them, but the chickadees would come and they'd look around, they'd say, there's not enough food here, we're not even gonna try to breed. If they did try to breed, they produced 1.5 fewer eggs. Those clutches were 29% less likely to survive. If they did survive, they produced 1.2 fewer fledglings, and it took them 1.5 days longer to actually fledge. And if you put all that together in a population growth model, this is what you get. As a function of the percentage of non-native woody plant biomass in your yard. We looked at woody plants because that's where chickadees forage. They're not foraging on the ground. From 0 up to 100%. This dotted line here is replacement rate. That's the rate at which the population has to make babies to replace the adults that die every year. If you reproduce at this level, you have a sustainable population. It's sustainable, it's not growing, but it's not shrinking either. If you make more babies than adults die, above the line here, you've got a growing population, and that happens when you have very few non-natives. But when you're below the line here, you've got an unsustainable shrinking population. There's more adults dying than babies that are being created by your landscape. Now right here, this is the good news, right here, liberally speaking, is where those lines intersect. So it suggests you can have up to 30% of your woody plant biomass non-native without destroying your local food web. Now none of those plants can be invasive plants. Invasive plants are ecological tumors. They don't stay in your yard, they escape and castrate your local ecosystem. But there are a lot of ornamentals that are not invasive. So this is the area of compromise. Remember this picture, Dan Getman's? I don't know if you noticed, but that's a ginkgo. Why does Dan have a ginkgo in his native planting? Because his wife liked ginkgos and she said, Dan, I would like a ginkgo. So there it is. Is it destroying the productivity of that landscape? No. Is it an invasive plant? Is it going to escape? No. It's just there. So I like to think of these types of plants as statues. So there you go. But how many statues do you want in your yard? It's not the presence of non-native plants that destroys food webs. It is the absence of those those highly productive contributors, the native plants that are supporting the food web. If we increase these, those keystone species, we can tolerate these without any ecological problem. Can we use native plants formally? Of course we can. This is a Lynn O'Shaughnessy design taken by a drone 400 feet up. It's a big garden. You don't get more formal than that, and every plant in that garden is a native plant. Formality is a function of the design. It's not a function of the plants in the design. Our native plants are used in formal designs in Europe every day. And I guess that's okay because they're non-native plants over there. Can we get a pollinator garden into a typical suburban yard like this without offending anybody? Sure we can. Put a little fence around it. It formalizes it. It convinces your neighbor that it's not a bunch of weeds you forgot to mow. It's meeting the needs of at least some species of bees. It's not very big. It could be bigger. But it's important to remember why we need pollinators. You hear all the time we need them because they pollinate a third of our crops. I don't like that explanation because people say, well, I don't live next to a farm, so I don't need any pollinators. And it's also incorrect. It's really about a twelfth of our crops. You need pollinators no matter where you live because they pollinate 80% of all plants and 90% of all flowering plants. If we lost our pollinators, we'd lose 80 to 90% of the plants on the planet, and that is not an option. Where do we need pollinators? Everywhere we need plants, which is everywhere. This is a Drew Latham design, much bigger. Imagine the amount of life supported here versus the amount of life supported here. Seems like a no-brainer. Can municipalities help us live with nature? Yes, they can. More and more of them are doing it. Minnesota, it kicked it off several years ago with a cost-sharing program. The state pays you to reduce or eliminate your lawn and replace it with appropriate Minnesota prairie plants. Very, very popular program. There's an island off Florida where the municipality's paying residents to allow burrowing owls, listed species, to burrow in the front yard. This is the way the Endangered Species Act should have been written, with carrots rather than sticks. If you have an endangered species on your property, we're going to pay you to be a good steward of that species rather than fine you if you use your property. Everybody would want an endangered species. Put a bounty on these invasive ornamentals like calorie pear. That's what St. Louis, Missouri did, Fayetteville, Arkansas. South Carolina has banned them all together. North Carolina has a bounty on it. Take out a calorie pear, you get a free tree replacement. Water utilities are giving people $100 coupons to put in water-efficient native plants as opposed to the thirsty non-natives. And, of course, the big lawn reduction programs in the West, in California, that's gone up. It's $3 per square foot rebate now. For every square foot of grass, you replace with xeric plantings. California does not have one drop of water to waste on a status symbol. And if you want more information about all of those programs, memorize that. All right, I think we've made three missteps in the early years of conservation. We're still in the early years of conservation. And the first one is pretty serious, I think. We're starting to think of nature as if it's optional. We like it, we like to visit it, we like to have it entertain us, but it's not essential. And if it's not essential, when push comes to shove, when resources are in short supply, nature takes a back seat. We will fund the things that are essential. I went to the Cincinnati Zoo before the virus broke out, and they have this wall-sized poster there, which to me epitomizes our society's view of conservation. We want to save nature, we want to save wildlife so that future generations can enjoy them. That was Teddy Roosevelt's argument for establishing the national park system. These are wonderful places, and we want to save it so future generations can enjoy and appreciate them. And I get that. Nature is enormously entertaining. But it's much more than that. We need to save nature so that we have future generations. A little bit more urgent. We've also assumed that nature, humans and nature cannot coexist. We talked about this, but again, if we restrict conservation efforts just to a few areas where there's not very many humans, we're going to fail because those areas are too few and too small. David Quammen has a wonderful analogy between a Persian rug and an ecosystem. That is a functional Persian rug. That's not 71 Persian rugs. That's 71 rug fragments, none of which are acting like a Persian rug, and that's what we've done to our ecosystems. The UN designates biosphere reserves as places of ecological significance. And I don't like that language because it suggests there are places on planet Earth with no ecological significance. Not so. Every square inch of the planet has ecological significance, including our yards, including our corporate landscapes, including our roadsides, even including much of our agriculture. So we've got to glue our rug back together again, folks. We've got to put the plants back, not just to make biological carters that connect viable habitat with each other, but to restore viable habitat where we've dismantled it. It's starting to happen. It is starting to happen. We need it to happen more and more quickly. But when it happens, it's going to be the first time in modern history that humans have coexisted with the natural world. Our third misstep was to leave Earth stewardship to just a few specialists, a few conservation biologists, a few ecologists. For some reason, we didn't see it as an inherent responsibility of everybody on the planet. But I don't know why. Because every single person on the planet depends entirely on the quality of their local ecosystems. So why wouldn't everybody share the responsibility of taking care of those ecosystems? Stan Rushworth, a Cherokee elder, once said, the Western settler mindset was, I have rights. The mindset of indigenous people is, I have obligations. You're not born with those mindsets, you're taught them. We've been very good at teaching this one. We've been terrible at teaching our kids and our peers that we all have obligations to good Earth stewardship, every single one of us. That doesn't mean that you have to save biodiversity for a living. But you can save it where you live, and if you do, it empowers you. So many people today feel powerless and hopeless. They know the Earth has a lot of problems. They want to do something, but they say, what can one person do? Well, one person can shrink the lawn. One person can fire Mosquito Joe. One person can plant a pollinator garden. One person can put in keystone plants. One person can get rid of the invasives that are already on their property. We didn't even talk about that. What I leave at. One person can turn out their lights or put in a yellow bulb. There's lots of things one person can do and totally reverse the productivity of their little piece of the world and enhance their local ecosystem instead of detract from it. And it shrinks the problem down to something that's manageable for each one of you. Don't think about the entire planet's problems. You get depressed. Just worry about the piece of the planet that you can influence. If you own property, it's obvious. It's where you start. If you don't own property, help somebody who does. Help a land conservancy, help a park, help a preserve. As a volunteer, they will love you. They're all understaffed, all underfunded. So as property owners or volunteers, each one of us has the power, and we certainly have the responsibility to fix dead landscapes like this. Whether or not we decide to do so is going to determine nature's fate, and ultimately our own fate. I think I've convinced my grandkids that you are nature's best hope. I hope I've convinced you as well. Thanks very much. Thank you. Thank you. Are you stretching again?
So I collected some questions that I'm going to ask on behalf of the audience. Thank you, Doug. That was really inspiring, and I learned so much. And one thing that I was super happy to hear, and it comes from a question from the audience, is that idea of compromise, because many of us, I think, have well-established yards and, you know, that great myrtle, and again, not talking invasive species, but those statue plants. Because one of the questions was, I've got these well-established plants in my yard, do I rip them all out and replace them with natives? And it sounds like that is not necessary as long as we find that balance between the natives and the non-natives. So I think, I hope that answers the question that you already answered it. Great. But on that, how do we prioritize the removal of invasive plants? And I mean, that's such a huge
that's
problem.
That's a good question. We have a lot of species of invasive plants that are already on our property. They keep coming in, new ones. You guys have porcelain berry yet? Great. I prioritize it by focusing on the woody plants, the ones that take up a lot of area, or those invasive vines that crawl over everything and eventually actually kill what they're on. Now, we've got stilt grass, and we've got garlic mustard and a bunch of smaller things, lesser celandine. I don't prioritize them. First of all, we don't know what to do with stilt grass. But you can drastically change the productivity of your landscape by working on those woodies. Then if you have time later on, you can play with the herbaceous ones. You know, Bern Blossy at Cornell has found, he's got this long-term study of different plots where he's treated garlic mustard in different ways, from pulling it out every year or every other year, or applying pesticides or doing nothing. And the plot that after, I think it's 25 years at this point, that has the least garlic mustard is the plot where he did nothing. And that's because you're not disturbing the soil and stirring up the seed bank anymore. And there may be a little chemical reactions where it actually kills itself over time. He doesn't really know, but he can guarantee if you're actively pulling it out, you will never get rid of it. So try the nothing approach. But I would prioritize the woodies, the multiflora rose and all those guys.
Yeah, great to know. From our online audience watching on nature, it's so exciting that so many people are enjoying this. Where do we buy or find all these wonderful native plant species?
Well, that has been a problem in the past. It's less of a problem these days because nurseries are realizing that this is a business opportunity. Right now, the demand for native plants exceeds the supply, so that's a business op. So more traditional nurseries are carrying more natives. There are more specialized nurseries popping up, and there are more people putting lists of suppliers online. We're going to try to do that. We're working to do that on Homegrown National Park. I don't even know where I am anymore. On our website, we're going to have a list of that as you move around the country. So is National Wildlife Federation. They're reworking the Native Plant Finder, so you can in your county, you can see a list of suppliers. The problem with that is it changes all the time, and of course it's regionalized, so I can't sit here and tell you where you can go and buy them. But the information is becoming more available. Google searches are really, really productive. Try to get somebody nearby. Don't go to Home Depot or Lowe's. That's your last choice, because chances are, even if they have the plant, which they probably won't, it probably won't be sourced from near you. So try to find a local supplier. But it's a problem that would be less and less of a problem as time goes on. You can go to your local nursery and say, I would like this plant. Oh, you don't have it? Can you get it for me? And if they say no, then leave. Don't buy something else. And then they'll realize, I just lost a sale. They'll start to get it.
Yeah, yeah. The customer drives, hopefully.
That's right.
So in thinking about, we saw like the little urban plot of the Leatris and Rudbeckia and different things. Someone asked if they have a number of little plots, how many plants are optimum of each species, or do you want to mix them all up, or do you want one bed of
Rudbeckia
or something like that?
The diversity versus abundance question. It's a great question, what you want is both. How about that? But there are real benefits. So that patch of Bidens that has colonized my front yard, and by the way, I didn't plant any of those. They came in on their own. All I did was stop mowing that section. There are benefits. It's one species, but there are benefits to having a big density of species like that because the pollinators don't have to fly very far between flowers. They can get a lot of pollen and nectar with very little energy extended. Diversity is a good thing, too, because then you're addressing more of those specialized pollinators. If you're talking about woody plants, if you have one oak tree, they're wind pollinated, they're not going to be able to get pollen from another one of the same species, and they'll never make acorns. So you want to have a minimal population viability there, which is for oaks, it's going to be at least two trees within wind blowing distance. So if you have a typical size yard, you cannot meet all of these needs in one yard. You should go with what your yard offers. If you've got full sun in a lot of areas, that's a great place for pollinator gardens. And you should focus on a sequence of blooms over the season. That would be the primary focus. Even if it's one plant blooming at a time, you're meeting nutritional needs, at least of generalists, as the season progresses. You know the no-mow May idea, where we are nice to pollinators in May, but we kill them the rest of the year? It's better to have no-mow places that you never kill all the pollinators, and you have a sequence of blooms. So diversity is great, but you do need a minimum abundance, too. I hear all the time people, they want to help the monarchs, so they plant a ramet of milkweed, and then the monarch comes and lays an egg on it, and it flies around looking for more milkweed. Oh, there's one, lays another egg. All of a sudden, there's three or four eggs on that one ramet. The caterpillars hatch, and they eat all the leaves, and the person gets upset. Oh, it just killed my milkweed. It didn't really. It'll come up from the roots, but it's not enough for them to complete their development. In a case like that, where you have a large caterpillar eating a lot of material, you need a milkweed patch. So knowing a little bit of what you're seeking will help guide you towards the amount of material that you need.
I'm going to sneak my own question in here, and that's wing stem. Are you familiar with yellow wing stem? Do you guys?
When I drove here, I'm familiar with it.
Yeah, because I've got 18 acres, and about 13 of it is covered in wing stem, and there's lots of thistle, but the pollinators are all over it.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Some people say it's invasive, but I think it is, yeah.
The definition of an invasive plant is a non-native plant that is aggressively displacing natives. Natives can be aggressive, but they can't be invasive.
Okay. This is an interesting question from our audience. He is interested in winter propagation of native seeds. Can you speak to that and how that might work?
Well, this is when I remind everybody I'm an entomologist.
Okay.
Their entire course is in plant propagation, and a lot of seeds need to break dormancy through the winter by stratifying them in cold. So that's a generality in the temperate zone. So that's all I'm going to tell you. It's much better to get a book on plant propagation, and it'll help you do that.
And while I'm going over here, what gives you hope for the future of the planet, Doug?
What gives me hope?
Yes.
The fact that you are sitting there. 10 years ago, this wouldn't have happened. There's more and more interest in this. That's the hope. People are waking up. We're realizing we got to do something. There's the hope right there. And it's doable. That's hopeful, too.
Hi, Doug. Thank you. My question is about a crossover within the same genus. I have a Quercus natalii, a nuthall oak, that is it's a southern tree, but it's doing very well because I have a clay soil, very compacted soil, and it's a very fast grower in the red oak family. So just because it's a native of Georgia, does it mean that I can't get caterpillars on my nuthall oak?
Okay, so how well are oak caterpillar eaters able to move between species of oaks? I actually had a student compare 16 species of oaks in terms of the ability of what's using them. They were all really, really good. The species that did the worst were the ones that were out of range. So we planted them in areas that escaped their herbivores. But oaks protect themselves primarily with tannins. So if you can eat an oak, you're adapted to eating tannins. You're adapted to eating leaves that get progressively tougher through the season. And that's a characteristic of pretty much all the oaks. So I would say the crossover within a group, within the white oak group, within the red oak group, is going to be excellent. Crossover between groups certainly happens. It might be a little bit less. Hasn't been well studied. You've got the live oak group, which what is that, Verentes? There's probably less crossover between the other groups and the live oak group. But I'm going to generalize and say if you can eat oaks, you probably can eat any of them. So I would pick the oak that's going to do best in your soil type and not worry about that as much.
Oh, okay. All right. So I've got the that sign from powers that be, and I know we could be here all night with lots of wonderful questions for you, Doug. I do have a note here. There's a local group, SaveOurSoilWV.com, that lists local native plant sellers.
Okay, good. Yeah.
So. All right, there we go. Local source. So SaveOurSoilWV.com. And on that note, thank you all so much for being here. And thank you, Doug.
You're welcome.
Really wonderful. Thank you, Alex.